Today we will talk about something that is much closer to what you do as a classical structural engineer. We will talk about structural integrity and structural reliability. So let's start with something everybody knows. Start with something, a simple supported beam. With a span L and with a load in the center. Call this load G. So this is something we know, right? And now we want to elaborate on this beam, and when we want to calculate the probability of failure of such a beam, then we have to develop a limit state function. That's a very central thing. And the limit state function for such a beam, given it has a rectangular cross section, looks like this. We have the moment resistance of the beam, and we have the load effect, both expressed in units of moments, right? And this is important. Of course, we make this comparison in the same unit. And also, we formulate such a limit state function that it contains a decision variable, right? So the decision variable in this case now is the height of the beam, as we would normally do. It's much more effective, as you see, to change the height of the beam in order to increase the moment resistance. And then we compare these two properties, resistance and the load effect. And then we can start with our elaborations. And this lecture now is how to solve this problem, how to compute the failure probability based on such a limit state function. And you can imagine this is a very simple example. Practical engineering problems are normally more complicated, but in order to illustrate the concepts, this is absolutely sufficient. So we have to deal with uncertainties, of course. If we would exactly know all the properties of this limit state function, then it would just be to decide whether, given our problem at hand, we are positive or negative with this limit state function, saying that we are, when this becomes negative, we have failure, and when it becomes positive, we have survival. When we would know everything, it would be, of course, no problem to see. But which variables would you say are uncertain in a typical problem here? Which properties we don't know exactly? The span? Yeah, the span maybe is something we don't know per millimeter or the tenth of a millimeter, but we might control it, as we can control the height of the beam and the width. But which one are... Material property and the load, right? So given the load is just a human person, a person, and the weight of the person, that's of course we don't know, when we don't know the person. And even if you would know it's me, then you would not know exactly how much it is. Right? So that's the uncertainty. We have uncertain properties. Under certain assumptions, we could assume that the geometry maybe is known, right? But the load and the material property, they are unknown. The material property could be, for instance, the bending resistance of a timber material. Right? So we have to deal with these uncertainties. We have to integrate, actually, random variables in order to solve this problem. So this is the link to yesterday. And this, just a little historical view, this is also a very new science compared to other things we do in our daily life. So this was first introduced in 1926 by a German engineer, but he was widely ignored by the engineering community. And this topic came to the surface of the general discourse end of the 60s. But this is a very fresh topic. It was not so much. And then there was also a Swedish guy at the same time. They did not communicate, but at the same time he wrote a paper where he is talking about that we actually have to minimize the cost when we construct a building. that we have to find a balance between the investments into more safety and the risk that the structure induces. So in our example, what would be the cost of more safety? Cost of more safety is related to the material use we have when we increase age. So we have a clear relationship between the choice of the height of the beam and the reliability. It becomes more safe when it becomes higher. And therefore, we have an interrelationship. We have a cost to pay in order to make, in order to reduce the risk. So we have to find a balance for that. That's again the example, the decision variable age. And now it's about finding age that we find satisfying. So actually, the search for right age is not only a problem of structural reliability. It's actually a problem of how can we optimally invest our money into the structure. Right? So the reliability itself is only an intermediate result that, seen on its own, has not such a big importance. Right? So how should we judge whether a yearly failure probability of 10 by the power of minus 4 is too high or too low? So we have to look what is it cost-wise. So we can use this limit state function. We can find a way to calculate the failure probability in order to solve such an optimization problem. So that's the objective. And now this is for design of a new structure. When we do structural health monitoring, we actually construct with the same principles a much more complex objective function where we also want to optimize the costs. But here now it's only finding an optimal height, that's our decision parameter, where we balance the expected costs, that's the risk. So if we choose a higher beam, then we reduce the risk, that's the blue line. But at the same time, we invest more in material, that's the green line. And there we find an optimum where both cost components are in balance. Right? And that's what we actually want to find out. But in order to do that, because we have to scale the damage costs or the failure costs by its probability that it occurs, it's the expected failure cost, we have to calculate the failure probability. So this, by the way, is not the main focus of today, but it's a definition of risk. Risk is defined as a sum of, when you have certain events that can occur, it's the sum of the contributors of this, risk contributors of these different events, and it's the sum of the probability of event happens and its consequences. So that's the definition of risk, and that's also here in the graph named expected costs, expected failure costs. So to conclude, we have to look at the objective function, and a very central part of this objective function is actually the probability of failure, as we see here. So this is the objective function expressing this optimization problem. And here we have the expected benefit being the benefit of the structure times the probability that the structure survives minus the cost of the design. This is what we invest in the structure. And minus the expected failure cost, that's the failure consequences times the failure probability. So we have the failure probability here two times. It's very important to know the failure probability in order to find this optimal. We find this optimum by deriving it over the cost of the investment, safety costs. And then we find this optimal. So that's the problem. We leave this problem now and concentrate us how to solve this probability of failure. So this is, I hope you have seen this before. We, for calculating probability of failure for academic problem, for a classroom problem, where we assume both the resistance and the load normally distributed and independent, that's the two conditions we have to have. Then we can construct a rather easy and straightforward scheme. We can define, based on these two normal distributed random variables, we can define a new normal distributed random variable, which is the safety margin M. And then we have to explore the mean value or the standard deviation of this safety margin M. And actually, we can calculate the probability that R minus S takes values smaller or equal than zero, which is equivalent to the event that M takes values smaller or equal than zero. So we can have this new mean value of the safety margin and the standard deviation of the safety margin, having it here in the standard normal operator. And we actually express the non-exceedance probability of zero for this normal distribution with a mean value mu n and the standard deviation sigma. And then this is already a very interesting result. This is minus the mean value of the safety margin divided by the standard deviation of the safety margin. And this is equal to minus beta. So beta is defined as the mean value of the safety margin divided by the standard deviation of the safety margin. So that's the definition of beta in this context, when we look at a very, very simple problem. Who of you has seen this before? Very good. Not everybody, huh? So back to the example here on the board. We have a limit state function. We assume that R and S are independent, normal distributed, random variables with known statistical characteristics. And so we write this like this. We have S and R being normal distributed with the mean value and the standard deviation. And then we can first draw a Lie's graph where we have a practical or where we have an illustrative idea about how the problem looks like. You see the resistance tends to be a little bit higher than the load. That's nice. But then we can construct a safety margin and with the mean value and the standard deviation. And then the probability of failure is here, this little part below zero. So it's the part integrated from minus infinity to zero. And this is for the normal distribution expressed with this standard normal operator, zero. So the reliability index has a certain geometrical interpretation. When we take the density function of the safety margin, the beta index indicates how many times the standard deviation of the safety margin fits between the mean value and zero. So if you have a beta value of 4, more or less the range where we are operating for structural failure, then we can put 4 times the standard deviation of the safety margin between zero and the mean value. So in reality, you see that when you have a little bit of experience, this is maybe a beta index of 1.2 or something like that. In reality, this curve is far apart from zero. You can put 4 times the standard deviation between the mean value and zero, and then we get probability values or yearly probability of failure that are in the range where we are operating normally, order of magnitude wise. So now we put some numbers on this example. It's meant really as an introduction. We have timber bending strengths with typical values. We have 40.8 newton per millimeter squared mean and standard deviation that corresponds to 25% coefficient of variation. And on the other side, we really look at the property of the weight of the force induced by weight of a human body, and we assume a mean value of 0.8 kilonewton and a standard deviation of 0.15. Then we have a span of 8 meters, and we had some properties of the cross section, 10 times 10 centimeters, and then we can calculate the probability of failure following that scheme. We have the mean value and the standard deviation of R and S, and then we can compute the mean value of M and the standard deviation of M, and then having the mean value and the standard deviation of the safety margin, we can compute the beta is equal to 3. Now we can do the following. We can say we measure or we weight the person that is standing on the beam. So we can say this person has 0.85 or induces a force of 0.85 kilonewton, meaning approximately 85 kilos. And now we know that. So we introduce information into this problem. And now let's recalculate or let's calculate back. So when you have 0.85 kilonewton, the mean value of the load effect, of the moment induced, becomes 1.7, right? 1.7. And the standard deviation is 0, because we know it. So 1.7, so just memorize 1.7. Here we don't change anything. And then we are here with the resistance, and then we have the 1.7 here. And the standard deviation now, it becomes much more easy because the standard deviation remains the same, right? So here we don't have 1.73, we have 1.7. And now we can look at, okay, what is 6.8 minus 1.7? That's 5.1, right? So we get 5.1 divided by 1.7. Please calculate.
0.3.
Pardon?
0.3.
Oh. So it's 3.
Yeah.
Very good. You have the clear mind. I'm not. So it's 3. That's interesting. That's an interesting result, right? So the reliability becomes only slightly lower. Even so, we know that the person we put on the beam is larger than the mean. So we have a person that is larger than the mean, but we know exactly the weight. So we induce some information. So the reliability remains the same. And that's due to the fact that these two probabilities now, these two probabilities of failure, are conditional to different sets of information. It's exactly what we tried to discuss yesterday. So at the same time, we could measure the stiffness of the beam. We could measure the stiffness of the beam, and of course the stiffness of the beam is correlated to the strength of the beam. So we could update our model for the resistance. If you have a very stiff beam, then we can somehow conclude that maybe it's also higher than the normal average. So we can introduce new information and we get a different probability of failure or reliability index. So we get two different reliability indexes for the same problem, but we have two times different sets of information. So that's the lesson learned in this very simple example. So this reliability index or the probability of failure, it's not a property of the beam, it's the property what we put into our analysis, what we know about the beam. Right? That's very important. And that's the entire principle of this decision theory that comes later today. So you can imagine in the real world, R and S, we can always, or in most of the problems, we can somehow classify in resistance and in load. And but the resistance and the load are very often functions, more sophisticated functions, functions of other basic variables, random variables. So the capital X, this is a bold, stands for a vector of random variables that we have to consider. So in general, this is not sufficient to look at it as simple as we already did. In general, we formulate a limit state function, we traditionally call this G, of a vector of random variables, and we want to elaborate on the problem or on the event that this g becomes smaller than zero, and when g becomes smaller than zero, then we define failure. So when we have this formulated, this more sophisticated or more generic limit state function, we can look at a two-dimensional case because it's still convenient to draw an illustration from. So here we now have a graph where we have the load and the resistance. So that's now a different way of illustrating this problem. We still have two variables, and we compute the joint probability density function of these two variables. That's now a different way of representing the problem. So we look at the joint probability density function from yesterday, this is these bell-shaped curves, right? Now we look at a two-dimensional density function, so it's a hill, like we have here many in the, around Lake Como, right? So we have this mountain here, and now we define our limit state. The limit state in our case was R minus S is equal to zero. So this is the same as R is equal to S. So in this diagram, this is just a 45 degree line in this diagram. So this 45 degree line is somehow used as a limit that separates this density function into a domain where we have failure on that side and the domain where we don't have failure. And in more mathematical terms, this can be expressed as follows. So we have the joint probability density function of our variables. In this example, it's R and S. In a more general problem, it could be 10 different variables. Then it would be very hard to make a drawing out of it, right? So this are R minus S in our example. So we integrate over this density function in the domain. This is the domain here, in the domain where the limit state function becomes smaller or equal to zero. So this is exactly what we do here when we draw this line, and we integrate on that side. So we, in this two-dimensional case, we have to find out the volume that is in the failure domain. That is actually this integral. And the entire structural reliability methods we look at today, mainly on two, is only for solving this integral. And we look at two different strategies solving this integral. This is a nice illustration from the time in Zurich. There's a group of Michael Faber. We developed a graph like that where we illustrated what the problem is about. So in more sophisticated problems, you see here, this are the altitude lines of the hill, right? And this hill now is not two normal distributions. It could be other distributions, so it gets a little bit skewed. And also what we have here is a nonlinear limit state function. This is also very typical for more sophisticated problems. So now we cut from this cake a piece, and we want to know the volume of this piece. Right. So this is the solution of this integral. We could, of course, use numerical integration. It's always used by people that not want to spend time in more appropriate methods. They use this integration with their nice computers. But this integration has many pitfalls numerical-wise, because we are operating on very, very small probabilities. So the volume we are talking about is very small. And as you might imagine that numerical integration is about, it's very sensitive to these assumptions, especially when we talk about very small volumes. So it's very tricky, especially when we have many variables and we have to solve this integration problem in multi dimensions. So we need more appropriate methods, and today, so these are a list of structural reliability methods. Some of them are always used in combination, so we first of all can have a first order and a second order reliability method. We look at the first order reliability method. We have surrogate models, response surfaces, where we, based on that, we normally operate then with first and second order reliability methods. And then we have Monte Carlo simulation. And now we will look first on Monte Carlo simulation. That's maybe the most straightforward and intuitive way to go. And then we look at the very elegant iterative solution scheme that is the first order reliability method. So Monte Carlo simulation is widely used. It was developed in the 30s and afterwards during the Second World War. And it's based on the principle of trial and error. So that makes it so intuitive, right? Many times in our daily life we do this trial and error thing, right? And Monte Carlo can be called exact when we assume that we do infinitive experiments, virtual experiments. So it converges always to an exact solution. That's a very good property, right? We have different approaches to implement this Monte Carlo simulation. We will look today at the inverse transformation method. We have also some other methods that are now just plotted here for information. We don't have time to look into that. The inverse transformation method is based on the principle that we can look at a cumulative distribution function, and based on this cumulative distribution function, we can, based on a random number between 0 and 1, we can produce a random realization from this distribution function. We look at that now in this graph. So here we have the cumulative distribution function. So the cumulative distribution function is related to the density function. Just to get sure that we are on the same page. So if we have the probability density function, PDF of a variable x, then we can solve the integral to a certain x, and we get the cumulative density function. That's now a little bit out of scale, sorry for that. That gives us this volume. Or that area here. So this y and this y is the same. That's the cumulative, but I hope you know that. So in the cumulative distribution function, due to the axioms of probability theory from yesterday, we know exactly that this is between 0 and 1, right? And most computer programs have at least most computer programs you're supposed to use have at least the possibility to generate random numbers between 0 and 1. And the random number generator between 0 and 1 produces uniform distributed numbers between 0 and 1. So we have a uniform probability that one of these numbers between 0 and 1 appears. Right? Now we can generate these uniform distributed random realizations. With such a realization, we can go into our cumulative distribution function and we can draw a realization that follows this distribution function. So by doing that, we transform this uniform distributed stream that comes into a stream that is distributed exactly as our cumulative distribution. And here are some suggestions when you want to implement this in MATLAB. When you want to do it in the old style, then you can use this U01. So this produces a uniform distribution between 0 and 1. But we can also use, and that's then much faster, use rand n. That makes already, so we don't have to use this transformation. We directly can produce a normal distributed random variable. And that's a so-called standard normal distributed random variable with a mean value of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. And then we have also some functions that produce other kinds of random variables directly. But now to introduce the concepts, we rely on this first simple and old school methodology, where we first produce a uniform distributed random number and then transform it to our distribution we want to have. And then the step number three, so we simulate many of these realizations. We simulate realizations from the resistance and from the load, right? And then we can plot them in our graph. So this is now the same graph that we had before, where we had this hill on, but we put it up. So the hill would be now here, right? And now we observe here a density of dots, and this density somehow reflects the density function we had before, right? So this is just a way to integrate. And the way to integrate is to count the numbers outside the line and compare this number with the total number. So that's a possibility to integrate something. Something for which we know that it has the volume of one, right? So the joint probability density function is a probability density function, it has a volume of one. So that's totally coherent to this integration to make this just with random draws and count the numbers. So, in this case, we have three observations in the failure domain, and in total we had 1,000 simulations. So the probability of failure is 0.003. So now we can go home, right? Do you believe this result is true? This is now an interesting thing, because this is pure frequentistics, right? So what would happen when we do another 1,000 experiments? It would be maybe a different result. Maybe we are lucky to find the same result, but there's a certain variation, right? When we now make an experiment, we make 10 times 1,000 experiments, and we compare our probability of failure estimates, there would be always different numbers. So there's a variability. And we have to reduce this variability by making sufficient experiments, right? So now, based on these results, if we would do 1,000,000 simulations, then we would get 3,000 failure observations. Maybe. This is based on this, so it's at least around 3,000, right? And this 3,000 would be much more stable, this number, compared to its total magnitude. So the variability is decreasing as more simulations we do. And we will look at some approximate formulas, how you can find how many simulations you should do later on. But we also had an analytical solution from before. This is actually the simulation of exactly the same problem. It's the Monte Carlo simulation solution for the problem we solved before with the two normal distributions. It's just for playing around. For this simple problem, it was possible to make it very simple as we did before. But now we are just for interest, we try to apply the Monte Carlo simulation to this simple problem. And we see that there's quite a big difference, right? So this is so to say the exact result we have.
Just a question.
Yeah.
You said that if you do another run, you will get another probability of failure because this is
statistical uncertainty.
Mm-hmm. So could you, for example, also consider that the probability of failure in this case could be a random error? So if you repeat other sets of calculations, you get another probability of failure.
Yeah, you treat it actually for Monte Carlo simulation. You treat the result you get out as an expected result. As an expected value, as a mean value of something, and you quantify the coefficient of variation of this result. Yeah. And then you can find out, we discuss this later, how much simulation should I do in order to reduce this coefficient of variation to 10%. So we will look at that result. So now we do this step by step. We generate first a random number. So this is something that comes out totally randomly out from our computer. Then we transform it to our resistance variable. And then we do the same for the load. Here it's important to say that we make a totally fresh draw of a new random number, meaning that we assume the load and the resistance to be independent, right? So we have now 0.69 and get our realization of the load. And then we have R minus S is the realization of the resistance minus the realization of the load. We get something that is bigger than zero. That means that experiment survived. And we can have this in our graph, and we see that it's far in the safe domain. And now we repeat this 1,000 times. Based on this one observation, we would say probability of failure is zero, right? It's totally nonsense, of course. But when we repeat this many times, then we get some observations in the failure domain. And now this coefficient of variation of our result, the coefficient of variation of our result is only dependent on the number of observations in the failure domain. It's only dependent on that. So when we want to detect something that is very unlikely, it's very low probability, this means we have to make a lot of simulations. And that's unfortunately the case for structural reliability problems. So we are talking about very low reliability or probabilities of failure, and that sets a very high demand on the number of simulations. Now we discuss something, so this was an easy start, right? It's not very complicated to do that. It's also only a few lines in your MATLAB sheet when you do something like that. But of course, reality is a little bit more complicated. Random variables are very often correlated to each other. And that we have to take into account somehow, because it makes a big effect on the structural reliability. So here we have a clear correlation between the variable R and S. So what? It's a negative correlation, right? And you see a negative correlation means that we have more observations in the failure domain. Because negative correlation means that when we have coincidentally a very high realization of the load, it's negative correlated, we got coincidentally a very low realization of the resistance. That's not good for us. We don't want to have negative correlation. When it's positive correlated, then it's other way around, then of course it's very nice. Huh? You don't even have any observation in the failure domain. Because positive correlation means that when we have a high realization of the load, we tend to get also a high realization of the resistance. So we have to take this correlation into account in our Monte Carlo simulation somehow. And that can be done by a method. In principle, we turn around maybe I'll make a little drawing about that. So when we have a correlated random variable in our coordinate system, then it might look like this. So these are the altitude lines of the hill, right? So they're inclined. And now what we do is we just turn the coordinate system in order to get a non-inclined curve. And when you have a non-inclined curve, this means that it's a no correlation, right? So this is what happens here. We transform based on our original coordinates. We get a coordinate x dash and y dash, and then we express in simplification, when we consider the correlation coefficient being the cosinus of the turning angle alpha, we can express the new x dash based on this correlation coefficient directly. So the algorithm we follow here to get a bivariate normal random variable that has some correlation that is described by the correlation coefficient rho is we generate x and y in the standard normal distribution, and then we calculate the new x based on the old x and the old y, integrating this rho according to this formula, and then we get a correlated pair of standard normal distributed random variables, which is the original x and the new x. So here we get non-correlated realizations of the b-normal distributed variable, and here we can transform them into correlated ones. And then we can transform this this x and this x prime into a normal distribution with a mean value and a standard deviation. Now we have to integrate, we have to introduce something that is very important also for the remaining part of this lecture. We do a transformation of the standard normal distribution. So the standard normal distribution. Standard normal distribution is a very boring distribution because it has always a mean value of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So that looks more or less like that. And here's 0. So now we have many solutions based on this standard normal distribution. It's very convenient to operate with this standard normal distribution. And based on this standard normal distribution, we can always generate a normal distribution by shifting from 0 to the real mean value and scaling the standard deviation 1 to the real standard deviation. So we shift and we might scale, and that's exactly done by this here. So based on the standard normal distribution, we can shift by the mean value, and this is our standard normal distributed variable, and we scale by the standard deviation. This is very ugly, so I give it a little bit more room. So we have our x variable, so we shift this, so we have mu plus x, and then we also have to scale the standard deviation of our new variable. So based on the standard normal distribution, we can produce any normal distribution by shifting and scaling. So this is what happens here. So this is how it can be implemented. So these are our two uncorrelated realizations of the standard normal distribution. Right? It's boring, it's around 0 here. And then we produce the correlated set. So we exchange this axis here with the new x prime, with a correlation coefficient of 0.8, and it looks like this. Now it's clearly correlated. So in the end, on this, we have exactly the same realizations, but we shifted them, we distributed them in this direction. And then we want to produce two random variables with a mean value of 3 and a standard deviation of 1. So this is the transformation to some normal distributions. Now we have two. It's a little bit boring in this example. Two with a mean value of 3. And the standard deviation remains the same as 1. When we want to have a standard deviation of 2, then we just set a 2 here. Right. So now we have correlated normal distributed random variables. This is how it is done based on some data. So we have x and y from the taken from the standard normal distribution, and then we transform this into the correlated variables that have a mean value of 3 and a standard deviation of 1. So now we, of course, want to do also normal Monte Carlo simulation. We are actually not so much bounded to the normal distribution anymore. Monte Carlo simulation, we can do things with any kind of distribution. We just have to transform over the distribution function. Now we could have the idea that we do that with an exponential distribution. So we produce two-dimensionally exponential distributed random realizations, and then we apply the same formula. And then we get something like this. This is, of course, nonsense. Huh? It's not allowed to do that. So this transformation is only allowed for standard normal distributed variables. But of course, people dealing with this are very bright, and they have good ideas. So the idea now is that we can generate a b-variate normal number, and then retransform these two multivariate normal distributed random variable into a correlated uniform distributed random variable or numbers, and then using the CDF of the normal distribution to retransform into the variable we want to have. So when we have a correlated set of uniform distributed random variables, then we can transform them actually in the distribution we want to have. Then we can, for instance, use the exponential distribution and transform it. And this is called NORTA, from normal to anything. So we always apply our correlation property on the standard normal distributed random variables. Then we transform them, the realizations, into a uniform distributed variable, and we can use this uniform distributed variable to inversely get the realizations of our variable of interest. So we generate, as we did before, a pair of correlated standard normal distributed variables, x, x prime, and then we transform them into the uniform distributed random variables. So we get correlated uniform random numbers, and with this correlated uniform distributed random numbers, we can generate our random numbers for our problem, for instance, exponential distributed, Gumbel distributed. So here we have an example. We again start with realizations of uniform of standard normal distributed random numbers. Then we transform them into a correlated uniform distributed random numbers. Then we transform them into the uniform distributed correlated random numbers, and then we make the transformation into, here for instance, an exponential distributed random numbers. So when we do that, the same example as before, but now we do the several steps over the standard normal distributed and uniform distributed random numbers. We apply this from normal to anything, and then we get a correlated set of exponentially distributed random numbers. So Monte Carlo simulation is a very straightforward tool to do things, even if you don't have the strongest background in this topic. But this might seem a little bit awkward to you, but it is very important that you at least can implement this, because in practical problems we very often have correlation, and it would be a really pity when the consideration of correlation in a Monte Carlo simulation would be an obstacle for you. So by looking at this more closely, now this is of course a very fast exposure to this, you have to look at it again, you are able, when you follow these different steps of these transformations, you are able to consider correlated random variables in your Monte Carlo simulation. Here's another example where that is not so boring. Here we have x1 and x2, and x1 is a Gumbel, following a Gumbel distribution, x2 is following an exponential distribution, and we have a correlation coefficient of 0.8. When you do that for more than two dimensions, then you can generalize this formula we had with a correlation coefficient and with this x prime and with the x with a use of the Cholesky transformation. So we search a matrix R for that we have the following properties, and then we can use this matrix R in order to transform Y in order to uncorrelated random variable X into a correlated random variable Y. So the correlation structure of our multiple random variables is defined by the correlation matrix. So we have, for instance, four random variables we look at the same time. Then we have a 4x4 correlation matrix. This is the C. I did not mention that. And this correlation matrix that we should find another matrix R that has the properties as indicated. And then we can use this R. Actually, we find this R by the so-called Cholesky transformation. Decomposition, and then we use this R for finding very straightforwardly Y, which is the correlated random variables based on the uncorrelated ones X. And that sounds, now you don't want to use algebra anymore, right? But with MATLAB, this is just a command, right? You have the Cholesky decomposition as a command. And then you can also make this vector operation here very straightforwardly. Actually, compared with what we looked before, more or less Excel-based with these tables, this is the much more straightforward way to do it once you have understood it. So for implementing in your code, this is actually the way to go. It's just two lines. Here's an example. I have to speed up a little bit. For this decomposition, so we get always a set of correlated standard normal distributed random variables based on uncorrelated set. So now we talk about accuracy of Monte Carlo estimation, and the accuracy is actually, as I said, dependent on the event we want to detect with a Monte Carlo simulation. It's dependent on the size of the piece of the cake we want to cut out from the normal distribution, from the joint probability density function. So we are talking about event probabilities that are very low, this order of magnitude, and that means when we have when we want to have a 10% confidence in the result, we have to do accordingly this number of simulations when we want to do that. Right? So this line is now for a confidence of 10%. When we want to be even more confident, then this line moves up. This is a guideline how many simulations we should do.
May I ask?
Yes, of course.
Here, when you speak about the number of simulations, is the number of one simulation or the total number?
No, the total number of virtual experiments.
Okay. So
the total number where you compute the limit state function based on your realization.
Okay. So if you generate your random variables of 1,000 experiments.
Yeah.
And then another one, the other 1,000 experiments, is 2,000.
Yeah, yeah, of course. No, no, you count on row. So it makes no sense to make 10 times 1,000, then you do just 10,000.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So because the other question was,
yeah.
In my mind, there is a little difference in between making one simulation with 10,000 or a different simulation with few experiments, in the sense that when you generate the random variable, the 1,000 you're generating one time are different from the 1,000 you're generating the second time. So usually in Monte Carlo simulation, it's better to have one simulation with many samples or many simulations with less samples.
That's an interesting question. When your realizations are independent, so when and then it makes then it's then 10,000 simulations is the same than 10 times 1,000 simulations.
If they are independent, it's
the same. Yeah, of course. You just accumulate your experiments and you always take as most as you can to calculate the failure probability. Yeah. So this is how the estimate based on the Monte Carlo simulation after a certain number of simulations. So we have a 10 by the power of 4 here. So here after 10,000 simulations, we can compute a failure probability that is that here. After only 1,000 simulations, we are here, right? So here we see how our result is converging towards the true result. So Monte Carlo simulation only provides a convergence towards the true result. Right? And now it's the question, when can we stop? Because when we stop, we just take this result, right? We don't know these two lines. And that, of course, also actually you can make a pre-posteriori analysis, how much computer time you can afford in order to increase the precision of your result. Right? So this is, in the end effect, it's the same principle. We have to stop somewhere.
And then when you stop there, you pick the last value?
Yeah, of course. We don't know this red line, so we would stop always here. Yeah, this is our expectation.
Okay, so the last number, an average?
No, this is the expectation. The number is supposed to get better and better, even though it does not look like that. Huh? Yeah.
So if it converges, in theory, if we could put in the number of simulations, it would give the exact result?
Yes, infinitive, yeah.
Okay. Mm. And is there an expression for choosing the number of simulations or only those graphs, for example?
Yeah, I have it, I think, on the next slide.
Ah, okay.
So this is an approximation when you want... So here you can calculate the coefficient of variation, or you can approximate the coefficient of variation for your Monte Carlo simulation result. This when you want to have 10%, then this is the way to go here. This gives you an approximation how much it should be.
And sorry, the number of simulations, does it depend also on the number of random variables you have or not?
No, it depends only on the observations in the failure domain.
Okay. Hmm. So if you have 2 or 1,000 random variables.
No.
That
yeah, no, no. It's only the numbers in the domain of the failure domain. Yeah. So just to, we don't go into that. We have variance reducing methodologies. We have methodologies that when we have a very computational expensive. Evaluation of the limit state, what would it be? So now we had the limit state R minus S. It's very fast to compute, right? What kind of limit states do we also know, especially for more advanced problems? What do we do in modern structural engineering? We do a finite element calculation, for instance. So for more advanced problems, we might do finite element calculation. And the finite element calculation, we don't have this calculation of the load effect, which is the central load times L divided by 4. We do something numerical, right? And numerical means that it costs time. So when we have for the evaluation of the limit state in our simple problem, maybe we have a millionth fraction of a second for the evaluation of 1. Right? It's very fast. We have a modern computer. We get a result like this after 1 million simulations. But given you have a finite element model and you need 0.1 seconds to evaluate that. 0.1 seconds, right? To evaluate one time the limit state function based on such a finite element. And then you want to do 10 million simulations. Then you have 1 million seconds. And you can easily calculate that gives you a problem if you have to submit your report next week. Another example is that, it appears fast, 0.1 seconds for a finite element. And you know models that are much slower. Another problem is very often our reliability estimate is only part of a bigger optimization problem, and what we discuss later today, this decision analysis is one example for it. So when the probability of failure is part of an objective function where we want to do an optimization, we have to evaluate this failure probability in one algorithm maybe 10,000 times in order to find an optimum for several solutions and things like that. And that's even for simple problems, then we are talking about the boundaries of what we can do with Monte Carlo simulation. So when we have complex program settings or very computational, costly evaluations of the limit state, we have to think about more effective methods. So we have to think about methods that make Monte Carlo simulation to converge faster. And we know methods, and I just give the keywords as important sampling or stratified sampling. And I just explain you the principle of important sampling without going more into detail, and then we make a little break. So important sampling is you do the same as we did when we did the Monte Carlo simulation. But Monte Carlo simulation seems very inefficient because we sample points actually mainly in the mean domain where we not at all expect failure. And we even sample points where we know exactly that there's no failure. Right? So we produce all these points only to find out these two guys here. It's very inefficient. Right? So now important sampling, the idea is that we move the focus of our point cannon, so to say. So we shoot the points actually around the point where we expect failure to be. And then we count these points, and there will be much more points on the failure domain. But we divide these points by its low probability that the points will take place exactly there. So that's a very efficient method. So we have the joint probability density function. We have the joint probability density function describing our variables. And now we formulate a so-called suggested probability function or proposed probability function. That's here. And now we can count a lot of points. We find out a very big integral on this side. Maybe it's in the order of magnitude of 0.5. But now we have to divide this by the low probability that our original density function is placed there or produces numbers there. So we calculate this large number of simulations, we calculate back by the low probability that our original points will end up there. So that's just to give you a little teaser to ask me in the break more about that. We will not have time to go into more detail. So now actually I want to conclude with warning. When you do this variance reducing methods, you should be very careful what you do, because you always make this problem biased and make open for possible bias. And bias is actually nothing we want to have when we do this virtual experiments. So now, after a small break, we will talk about the second strategy to solve this integral. And the second strategy to solve this integral is the so-called form analysis. So the idea to solve this integral now is different. Before, we just used a cannon and throw balls in order to represent this density, and then use a very simple relation between the number of points in the failure domain divided by the whole number in order to solve this integral, right? Now we do a different approach. So first of all, we have to recognize that this is now our graphical representation of this two-dimensional case. So we look at the joint probability density function that is represented by its altitude lines, like in a topographical map when you go hiking, right? And here we have the limit state as a line. And this is the case where we have two random variables. When we have three random variables, it becomes very hard to illustrate already. and then the limit state becomes a plane, right? And when we have a higher number of variables, then we talk about a hyperplane. So the limit state is then describing a hyperplane. So now we stick to this graphical representation and we look at it again. So we have the problem here described in the so-called original space, where we have the random variables with the real means and the standard deviations, and where we have the limit state function in the original space. And now we transform the entire thing here into the standard normal space. And there we have a mean value of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So we always have these concentric circles. So these circles in the standard normal space, they look always the same. But still, we represent now this individual problem in this space. So how it is possible? Where's all the information gone from the distribution functions in the original space? Where's the information? Where is it? That's a question.
In the limit state function.
That's in the limit state function. Very good. And how does it come into the limit state function?
No,
it's in the limit state function. Now it's here we have the limit state function g from R and S equal to 0. And here we have the limit state function in the standard normal space, which is a function of u r and u s. And these are standard normal distributed random variables. Right? So we remember this transformation rule. And we write down g from R and S is equal to R minus S. And we know that R and S are normal distributed. R is a random variable, right? It's normal distributed. It's a mean value of R and the standard deviation of R. And also S is normally distributed with a mean value of mu S and the standard deviation of sigma S. Right. So how do we get from this G from RS to G from UR and US? We transform also the limit state function into the standard normal space. So we represent the limit state function not in as a function of R and S anymore. We represent it as a function of U, R, and U, S, which are standard normal distributed. And how do we do that? We use the transformation as we did before. So we write G from U, R, U, S is equal to mu r is the first one, then you continue.
Plus x multiplied with standard deviation.
Yeah. Oh, it's r, no? Sorry for that.
It's you.
No,
you.
Yeah, I'm a little bit tired, I'm sorry. So I write it again for you very, very clearly. Right? Equal to mu r plus u r, standard deviation of r. And then to make it more clear, we make minus, and then we have mu s plus U S sigma S. And now we have the entire information of our problem, the probabilistic information, the individual information from the mean and standard deviation of our two variables we have in this equation. And this allows us to make our entire continuation of our solution based in a standard normal space, where the probabilistic information from the standard normal space itself is always the same, right? But we put the mean value or the probabilistic characteristics of our problem, we put directly in the limit state equation by this transformation. And now this transformation is very important. Sorry for that. This transformation is very important because now we are still talking about normal distributions here in the original space. But without going into more detail, when we have non-normal distributed variables in the original space, we can also use some kind of transformation in the standard normal space that is a little bit different than that one, but it's always possible to make transformations that we can go into the standard normal space. For instance, you find solutions in one of the examples I distributed for the Gumbel distribution. So when one of the variables is Gumbel distributed, typically it would be the load, then we can make a transformation. But then the transformation is such that our limit state function in the standard normal space becomes nonlinear by this transformation from the Gumbel distribution in the standard normal space. So that you are asked to look up in this one of these examples. And now we are in the standard normal space, and normally in the standard normal space we don't draw these circles anymore because they're always the same, so they contain no information. And in the standard normal space we skip the circles. Even so, saying it, we still have it there, but later on we have skipped the surface. And now we look at our limit state equation in the standard normal space. And the limit state function could be nonlinear, right? Due to transformation from non-normal distributed random variables, but also due to the fact that our mechanical problem is a nonlinear one, right? Could be nonlinear. And now the beta index gets a new graphical interpretation. The beta index is actually the point where the failure surface is closest to the origin in the standard normal space. So that's beta now. So now it's about finding an algorithm in this space here to detect the smallest distance between the origin and the failure surface. And we do that now by a first order reliability method. We do that by an approximation where we have a time gain in this point. And we say the failure probability we assess based on a surrogate limit state that is linear in the design point. So the closest point from the limit state to the origin is called a design point. So that's a linear approximation of this limit state in the design point. So we have a standard normal distribution here. We have a linear approximation of the limit state function. We have this distance here between the design point and the origin. And now you see the graphical interpretation is still the same than before. This distance reflects how many times the standard deviation, which in this case is 1, fits between the origin and the design point. So it's kind of similar of what we did before, but in a two-dimensional space. And now it's worth mentioning, relating it to your normal engineering practice, where you use characteristic values and partial factors for doing an engineering design. So what is the resistance characteristic value divided by the partial factor? How do we call it? It's the design value, right? And the design value of the resistance and the load is actually found exactly here. So this is what we want to represent also in the partial factor design format. This is the so-called design point. And on one side, we have the design point for the load. And in the other dimension, we have the design point for the resistance. So this partial factor design format is directly related to these considerations. So now don't look at these formulas. I explain them in a minute. Now we look at this standard normal space. And as I indicated, we skipped concentric lines. We just have our failure or limit state function equal to zero in the standard normal space.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A question from the previous slide. What means that alpha?
Which one?
Below the alphas. You have a vector.
Oh yeah, that's a direction vector.
Of the curved surface.
Yeah. So that's the normal vector to this tangent here. We will come to that now. So here we have the limit state function equal to zero. That's missing here. So g from u1 and u2 is equal to zero. This is this line here. And now we already agreed on that the beta we find where we have the closest distance between this limit state and the origin. That was the definition of beta. And now how do we find this beta? So we can, of course, make a drawing like this, and then we use our ruler and try to find it. But in a mathematical and generic, and especially in a multidimensional case, this is not possible. So we need an algorithm that we can illustrate or exemplify on this easy example, two-dimensional. That is possible also to solve in a 12-dimensional space, right? So therefore, we look now on the two-dimensional space, even so it would be straightforward to find it by hand. We now define a generic algorithm that can be used and that can be implemented, and that finds the solution, the closest point on the failure surface to the origin, surprisingly fast and efficient. So now, this is what we search for, and now we introduce the algorithm. So we have a problem at hand, and we don't know how it looks, right? But we can define this failure surface equal to zero, the limit state equal to zero, and we can start with a first estimate of the alpha values of a direction vector. So this is a normal vector that has a certain direction. It has the length of 1. And it has two coordinates, 1 and 2, corresponding to u1 and u2. So this is just a direction we have to indicate as a starting value of the algorithm. And typically, when we look at the entire coordinate system, we have two directions, or four directions, negative and positive, right? You have the load direction and the resistance direction, right, in the standard normal space. And now we have to think about where to shoot first. Where do we expect the design point to be? So do we expect to the design point to be in the lower domain of the resistance? Is it a low realization of the resistance that leads to failure? Yeah, and it's a high realization of the load that leads to failure, right? So we expect failure at the high realization of the load and the low realization of the resistance. So that means, that's not indicated here, that we actually have to shoot in the negative resistance direction and in the positive load direction. That's where we would suppose the design point to be. This is our first direction we shoot, and then we solve this equation. Actually, we search for the given direction. We search for the point that lies on the limit state equation exactly in that direction. And that means that we put the alpha from the direction vector, from the normal vector, times beta, into the limit state function, and we search beta such that the limit state function gets zero. So in practice, we just search the point that lies on the limit state function in this direction, because this function here is defined as being g from u1 and u2 equal to zero. And then we, from this equation, we get out the beta, So that's what we get out here. So we have a design point that is beta alpha 1 and beta alpha 2. So that's now a point that lies on the failure surface. But it's still not our design point. It's still not the point that is closest to the origin. Do you agree? So it's some point in some random direction, because this was the direction we initially shoot at, right? And we don't know where the design point is. So what we do now is we have a tangent. We have a tangent on this failure surface, exactly in that point. And that's what we're doing here. Here, by these partial derivatives of the limit state function over u times beta times alpha, we can compute the direction vector or the normal vector of this tangent. So that's just so that's now the direction vector that is orthogonal to the tangent, and that is now defining the new direction we shoot at. So you see, this is orthogonal tangent here, and that's our new direction to shoot at. Now in this new direction we search again. Now we iterate, right? We move to that point again. We search for a point that lies directly on the limit state. We linearize again. That's that part again. So we do it repeatedly. We linearize again and get the green line. That's the tangent in that point. And based on this tangent, we have the new normal vector, which is the green one. It's coming out very nicely with this beamer. And then again, we search the point on the limit state. And repeat that. And we will find out that actually it's surprisingly fast. After a few iterations, you come to the closest point to the origin. And this is then our design point. And the beta we find out in our last iteration scheme, where we have somehow defined criteria where we can stop this algorithm, where we are satisfied with the position of the result. This is then the beta that is the beta we use as a result. So the time constraints are not such that we can go more into detail to that, but I have prepared in the folder you received from Sebastian, you find this presentation. And then you find also a folder with two exercises, nice PDF files where you have some text that further explains these principles, but also introduces one example about the Monte Carlo simulation in one document, and in the other document an example about this form analysis. And it's actually not possible that you now one-to-one know how all these things work after this lecture. The time constraints of this course does not make it possible. With my students in Trondheim, I have 4 or 5 lectures about this, right? And exercises and things like that. But now, of course, you are adult, you are PhD students or postdocs. You go now to these documents and you try to implement these principles. And as you have seen yesterday, once you have implemented something, it loses somehow its fanciness. It's really not rocket science. And it's explained even with graphical animations, this form algorithm, based on an example of a serviceability limit state. So the probabilities of failures we get out are much higher. But it's a very illustrative sample, and if you really want to learn this, then you should spend some time this evening or later on to go through this exercise. It's really an opportunity. Now you already start thinking about this. Now it's actually the time to go through this. And I'm sorry for this brevity, but it was not possible to make it more in 1.5 hours, Monte Carlo and form analysis. But what I don't go through this text, but more principle, what we should understand when we have a nonlinear limit state function and we use the first order reliability method, then we make an error. We know that because it's an approximation. And somebody seeing the part of the cake we are actually not assessing correctly here. So the reliability analysis was finding out what is the volume of the cake we cut out from the mountain, right? We cut out, by the first order reliability method, we cut with a straight knife. That's the linear assumption, right? We just cut it up. But the real limit state function is actually a crooked knife. So this volume here between, this volume here, we don't count. So in this case, the real failure probability is lower than the failure probability we calculate by the first order reliability. Because the part we cut off is a little bit larger than the part originally should cut off by the limit state function. So this is the error. Luckily, the error is, or the distance is very, very small in the area where the slope is still steep, right? So it gets a little bit bigger, but this is in the domain of the mountain where we don't have much volume to count. So this is actually not counting so much, because there we are already in the valley. But we have to be aware about this inaccuracy. There's another method. You might have wondered what the second order reliability method means. That's actually not a linear approximation of the limit state, it's a quadratic one. And then the error becomes a little bit slower, a little bit less. That's just a final concluding remark about this form analysis. It's an approximate method. You don't get exact results. With a Monte Carlo simulation, when you have an easy problem, it's easy to implement 100 million simulations. There you will get a much better result based on that. But it's very fast. You will be surprised how fast this iteration I introduced converges. And that's the strength of this algorithm. So when we have a problem where we have to have a fast result in a complex optimization problem, that is actually the way to go. Any questions? Yes?
I just have questions about those alpha factors.
Those
are the so-called weighing factors, right?
Yes, they are the same than you use, for instance,
have,
for...
We this. Have alphas as much as the random variables.
Yes.
So this one for two random variables, two-dimensional space. If you have seven, then
you
have seven alphas.
So the alpha values, they are also used in the Eurocode for design assisted by testing. This is the same alpha values. And the alpha values, they are called sensitivity factors, and they indicate the importance of the variance of a variable for the reliability problem. So that's the contribution when you want to go back to the very easy safety margin case, which we introduced before. It's the contribution of the variability of one variable to the variability of the safety margin. Good. I'm a little bit over time, but now we have maybe 20 minutes for a break, so we meet 5 minutes after half. So 20 minutes is appropriate to eat at least two pieces of cake.